Good evening, everybody. I'm Jack Boulware. This is Jane Ganahl from Litquake. Thank you for coming. This is our event here, No Shadow Without Light, Writers Respond to Trump. Thank you so much to the San Francisco Public Library Caret Auditorium for hosting us here tonight. We are also streaming live on YouTube around the world.
So I encourage the authors to be as blue as you possibly can. Just kidding.
Zahra is definitely going.
In the words of Margaret Atwood, I believe in the resistance as I believe there can be no shadow unless there is also light.
So people were asking us why we decided to do this event. Well, it's pretty obvious if you look at the news every day. And as with the majority of the United States, our organization, Litquake, was festering over the recent election, the accusations, the grudges, the exaggerations, the lies.
And to be honest, in our last board meeting in December, our fabulous board members said, we need to do something, and we hardly agreed. And this came together with lightning speed, and so we're so grateful to everybody. This week, as we know, there's going to be marches and protests in over 600 cities around the country. So we personally at Litquake have a message for the president-elect. We know that you like to count numbers in crowds. Thank you very much for uniting America. We do feel very united right now.
So in times like this, it is the duty of the creative class to stand tall, report, and hold account. We are very proud to present tonight's diverse and eclectic Bay Area literary voices who speak to our nation's fear, anger, and perhaps even optimism.
We're hoping there'll be at least an ounce of optimism. Special thanks to all of the authors participating tonight. I did want to let you know the sad news, which is that the storm has forced cancellation of three of our speakers tonight, Ishmael and Tennessee Reed, as well as Faith Adiel. We're sorry about that, but nature intervened. We do want to thank Luis Herrera, the librarian here. Fabulous man. As well as Michelle and David and everyone else here from the public library. And also to our Litquake volunteer team tonight. If you see someone wearing a green t-shirt and have a question about Litquake, ask them. If you feel charitable and inspired after this, there are any number of organizations that could use your help. Not just Litquake, but, you know, Planned Parenthood, ACLU, Friends of the San Francisco Public Library, please put your pocketbook where your hearts are.
We also have some books for sale in the lobby. You might have seen as you came in. And before we begin tonight, we want to introduce a special guest. He served as San Francisco Public Library's city librarian since 2005. How many years is that? That's
12.
Is it? Yeah. Okay. And under his guidance, the city has opened, I'm sorry, I was a liberal arts major. under his guidance, the city opened or renovated 22 branch libraries throughout San Francisco. How about that? In 2012, he was nominated to the National Museum and Library Services Board by someone named President Barack Obama. Please welcome Luis Herrera.
Thank you so very much, Jane and Jack. First of all, it's 24 branches, not that we're counting, instead of 22. And yes, it's been almost 12 years, and who's counting? I'm really, really, it's a job of a lifetime. I'm very honored to be your city librarian. So I want to welcome each and every one of you to the San Francisco Public Library. What a remarkable turnout. I'm honored to host this event tonight with such an esteemed group of writers. And it's particularly fitting that the library is hosting this forum to give authors the opportunity to express their rights to free speech and to speak out about their concerns regarding the possible threats to the freedoms and ideals that we hold dear. If I may, I'd like to just take a moment of personal reflection on the election. On November 9th, I awoke to a different world. I know I wasn't the only one that felt the loss, disappointment, and disillusionment in the choice that our voters made, diminishing and devaluing our country's core principles of inclusion, tolerance, and enlightenment by choosing evil over goodness. As a Latino and son of immigrants, I felt like a loose thread had been pulled from the fabric of our nation's tapestry, tattered and discarded. I'm certain my brothers and sisters in other walks of life, people of color, immigrants, the LGBTQ community, and women had their own feelings of despair and sense of betrayal. It was very difficult coming to work that day. We were convening a group of staff to talk about the future of libraries. It was hard to concentrate, much less to envision a future. So instead, we focused on the passion and the value that librarians and libraries play in our democracy. I was encouraged by the unwavering commitment to ensure that libraries are sanctuaries that provide a safe and neutral space for ongoing dialogue on the issues that are facing our nation. I also reached out to all of our staff with an email message to remind them that our libraries are places that support the values of equity and inclusion that mirror San Francisco's values. The response was amazing and inspiring. We also take seriously the protection of our users' privacy and our role in providing information and community space that is free and accessible to all. These are the basic tenets that we follow, and we remain confident that we'll be able to continue these practices no matter who is in the White House. The value of libraries cannot be denied, and in fact, in the shadow, we bring the light to our community. So while tonight's program is politically focused to tie in to Friday's inauguration, it also comes at the time when the library is recognizing the importance of diverse books and diverse authors on our shelves. We are spending the entire month celebrating a series of programs we call We Love Diverse Books that brings together authors and showcases people for all ages, especially children, that reflect the diversity of our city. And here's a brochure. It's an amazing array of programs throughout our branches and here at the main library that I encourage you to really, really promote and help us advocate for more diversity in our publishing industry. In closing, I want to acknowledge the great work that Litquake and the Friends of the San Francisco Public Library as our partners do in supporting and bringing this kind of programming to all of us. Thank you, Litquake founders Jane Ganahl and Jack Boulware. We appreciate the work that you've done and continue to do. And Marisa Pella, I know she's in the audience, the executive director of the Friends of the Library. If you want to support democracy, free speech, and free expression, I encourage you to support these worthy community institutions. Thank you, and welcome to the San Francisco Public Library.
Thank you, Luis, and sorry about that, 24 Bronx libraries.
Shortchanging the librarian is a bad idea.
It's a bad idea, bad precedent.
So we want to introduce to you now your host and MC for the evening, who is an extremely formidable woman with many hyphens in her qualifications. She's an Iranian-American, feminist Muslim, comedian, co-host of the internationally acclaimed podcast, Good Muslim, Bad Muslim. Next month, she debuts her one-hour comedy special on behalf of all Muslims at Oakland's Islamic Cultural Center. And just this morning, she had a personal essay on Terry Gross's Fresh Air, so check that out online. Please welcome Zahra Noorbakhsh. How are you guys doing this evening? Yeah?
Give me joy like it's a weapon. Like a weapon. So I'm a Muslim. When I say weapon, it's got to be a little bit bigger than that. Give me joy like it's a weapon. Let me hear joy. It's just going to take me 2 minutes. The TED Talks are my side religion. Are we into that? Are we into oxytocin? How do we feel about oxy? Yes? I got one yes? Yes? Take up space, big shoulders, big breaths. We've got a lot to do. This is the library, but I am not quiet. On my way here, I was at first hit with this blustery wind, right? And this terrible weather. And I was just like, oh God, fuck you too. And then I realized me and Mother Earth were both crying. That's where we're all at. I'm also just enjoying that, at the end of every punchline, all of us are just a collective, oh yeah. I am a feminist Muslim Iranian American comedian. Thank you. I say Iranian. People get scared by this. I like to have fun with it. I like to sit in the front row of nuclear physics classes. Excuse me, professor. This plutonium. Can you find that on the Craigslist? Excuse me, professor. When are we going to make a nuclear bomb? This guy came up to me at a Whole Foods. And he said, what's a Persian? What's an Iranian? What is that? Why do you have two things? I'm just one thing. I'm just an asshole. And then right after that, he was like, what's a spring onion? What's a scallion? So what if I don't have shallots? Can I use a scallion? Is it the same as a spring onion? Can I add green onion? And then he ran for president, and he won. And that's how my year's been going. I feel like sometimes I get so saturated by hearing just the word Muslim in the press. First of all, I want to say the Republican Party owes me residuals. All right? I don't care if they're pennies. I would be a billionaire. I helped a man get elected by my very existence, I would like to say. And I believe I am owed royalties. Thank you. Sometimes I just want to change the name so I don't hear it anymore. You know what I mean? Persians figure this out. During the Iranian hostage crisis, somebody would run up to you with a bat, say, are you Iranian? Oh no, I'm Persian. I don't know what that is. That sounds very bad. Do you like to dance? You like to party? These are my Prada shoes, baby. What's going on? Sometimes I just want to change the name to Baba Ganoush. Because then instead of Islamophobia, people would have to say Baba Ganoushophobia. The pundits would have to say it. This is another case of Baba Ganoushophobia. Why Baba Ganoushophobia? I don't know. I love eggplant. I don't understand it. I can't get it. Is it because food trucks solve for racism? Right? That's how we lift sanctions. It's like, do we like Cubans? Oh my God, Cuban sandwiches? Oh yes, absolutely. Yes, yes, yes. I saw that food truck. Yes. Because we need a Persian food truck. And then we're good. Thank you. Everybody else is like, no, but when I eat global treats, it's because I'm a worldly individual. It's fine. We all do our part in different ways. Tell you a bit about my dad. My dad has two favorite words in the English language are the shit and the hell. He came to my dorm in college. What the shit the hell is this, Zahra? And that's a lot of what I hear lately from him also, is just watching the news. What the shit the hell is this, Sarah? What the shit the hell is this, Zahra? I'm very excited that I am here with so many authors that I admire. I have a couple of pieces that I'm workshopping. I just thought maybe I would read them. And then you guys could just tell me, like, the triple A's, like, what grabbed your attention? What did you appreciate? What actions do I need next? Just workshop a couple of pieces. Muslim in space. Ah. I just feel like it would go really well. I like to take advantage of opportunities. I'm married to a white man. I have a white man. Thank you. Very happy with my white man. I think every person of color needs to own one white man. So Obama has Joe Biden. Just, hey, here I am. It's gonna be white. So whenever I'm at the bank and my Muslim rage comes in, just bank fees. I'm sorry, that was my Muslim rage. This is my white man. Go be white. It was really effective. I feel like white guys are the golden retrievers of the doggy kingdom. You know what I'm talking about? Like, I have a mediocre white man. I don't really like exceptional white men. This feels a little bit oppressive. I'm just not into it. I just don't like it. Like, I don't like seeing confidence in a white man. Like, I don't appreciate that. I just really appreciate it. Just, like, bring it down right here. Right? Some of my friends who are women of color are like, I am not dating a white man. I do not want to come home to that. But sometimes I just want to, like, fake news is a thing. Why can't I have it at home? I love coming home to my golden retriever. Just, I just want a friend. I just want to be a friend. I just want to be your friend. What's wrong with the C+? I don't understand. I just want to be a friend. So, like, everybody who never got an A- totally understands, and everyone else is like, what is wrong with a C+? You were just talking about TED Talks. Confidence builds on confidence. I don't understand. Whenever I had an A-, my dad would be like, what the shit the hell is this, Zahra? So then I would go, I would study, I'd bring home the A. What the shit the hell is this, Zahra? Why is not the A+? So then I would go, I would study, I'd bring home the A+. What the shit the hell is this, Zahra? Why you take such an easy class? It's no winning. So I introduced my white man, he's an infidel, he's an atheist, to my dad. And my father goes, what the shit the hell is atheist? He didn't know what an atheist was. And I realized in Farsi, there's just 7 slurs. It's like, he who denies God too, you know. And so I was like, oh, well, he doesn't believe in religion so much as he believes in science. And my dad was like, you mean that Tom Cruise shit? And I was like, oh, how did this just get worse now? And I was like, no, and I was trying to explain it to him, and he's like, what's this atheist? It's like some Christian shit or something like that? It's okay, Zara, it's okay. Christian, Jewish, Muslim, atheist, we all believe in the same damn shit, okay? We all believe in the God. We surrender to that God. And he says the word Muslim just means one who surrenders to a force greater than himself. I was like, well, he's not spiritual, Dad. He doesn't believe in any God, no God. He believes that we have religion due to the lack of a real economic infrastructure. And my dad goes, does he believe in gravity? Gravity is a force greater than himself. He surrenders to that force. He's a Muslim. So welcome to the religion of Islam, everybody. It's a good time to be Muslim. They say there's no such thing as bad PR, so. We're gonna have fun tonight. All right, are you guys ready for our first reader of the evening? Yes? Our first author is a California-born granddaughter of immigrants, documented and undocumented. She served as San Francisco's 3rd poet laureate and has written many books of poetry, fiction, and biography. Her most recent collection is titled, And Then We Became, Here's Devorah Major.
Please give her a round of applause.
Okay, my dream is to write funny someday. I don't write funny. Okay. I was having a chai in the lobby and I broke my glasses. It's been a day. I've got four pieces, three of them by me, little pieces. This first one is Noma, How We Came to Speak. Noma is an African god force who created humans and it didn't work out the first time. So Noma was, you know, okay, I'll do it again. Like the first ones were like out of clay, and I said, okay, I'll do it again. And the next ones were like woven, and that didn't work out. And so Noma said, the word, I'll do it out of the word. So this is how we come to speak. Before a generation passed, we children of the third world knew how to take the gift of language, contort it crimson, and sew it to our teeth. How we mangle this tongue that needs unending translation. We require it to be a constantly changing chameleon, a hypnotist, a con man, a cheat. With words, we manufacture demons who devour souls and erase memory. Look at how often we honor speech that can make us hate, that can cause us to deny our mothers, our brothers, ourselves. We have articulated a deadly weapon that subverts knowledge and betrays faith. So how now do we again learn to listen with more than ears, at once try to speak with more than tongue? How now do we put our tongues back in our mouths? Okay, this next one has become a necessary mantra of mine. It's by Lucille Clifton, and I really do mean that. It's like, get up in the morning, okay? Won't you celebrate with me? Won't you celebrate with me what I have shaped into a kind of life? I had no model. Born in Babylon, both non-white and woman, what did I see to be except myself? I made it up. Here on this bridge between starshine and clay, my one hand holding tight, my other hand. Come, celebrate with me that every day something has tried to kill me and failed. Okay. And this is the part of the piece before the computer froze that I wrote for tonight. The other part of the piece you're not going to hear. It will take more than words to stem this tide, not enough to spit on a blazing fire, not enough to use a teacup to empty water from a sinking craft. True, mothers have been able to raise a car off of their compromised child. True, children have walked miles in snow to save their wounded parent. But this is not a time to plan on miracles, to depend on a messianic savior, to lift us out of this hell we have created through apathy or inattention, through greed or selfishness, through privilege or ignorance, that we not slide further back into voter suppression, that we not slide further back into patriarchy and misogyny, that we not use fear instead of reason when faced with religious bigotry, that we not pretend that racial fear is not a major part of this equation, that we understand it is not Chicken Little screaming about falling skies. It is to admit that taking America back has more to do with white frustration and terror than with going back to a better time, better before unions, better before OSHA protections, better before the environmental agency saved some wetlands, cleaned some rivers, reduced some smog. This is a time for ordinary people to do ordinary things in concert with conviction, to show up, to stand up, to speak out, to demand that we keep moving forward. And this last piece is called Snap. I have one of my BC friends, that's before children friends. Those of you who have children know there's very few before children friends you have. And, we are talking, everybody's getting so depressed, right? And she's like, oh, no, it's going to snap just like that. She reminds me how when we were teens, we were Negroes, and then snap, we were black and proud. Moving forward, claiming victories every day on our streets, in our schools, in our souls. We've always been an elastic people, able to snap ourselves time and time again. Kat says she can feel it, smell it in the air, sweet and sour like it was then, only with more love this time, and in a sharper, even more dangerous edge. Then, like now, things were seething. People were hungry and unjustly imprisoned and miseducated and drugged. But then, as civil rights' long pull was bearing fruit, we snapped into a revolutionary force, climbed inside our ancestral core, snap, made our music sing change, snap, made our dances say now, snap, locked arms and spirit, snap, became a dark, snap, moving, snap, tied a purpose, snap. We sharpen in the rhythms again, bringing out the drums, snap. Tightening up, even though we've been tossed by storm and cracked in the wind, we coming back together, snap. We got to snap, we got to just pull in and believe it and snap this mother back into place. I thank you.
Ah, oh, that was amazing. Yes. One more time, please, for Devorah Major. Our next author is author of the best-selling historical biographies, The First Tycoon, The Epic Life of Cornelius Vanderbilt and Custer's Trials, A Life on the Frontier of a New America. He is twice recipient of the Pulitzer Prize, a Guggenheim Fellow, and has taught creative nonfiction at Columbia. Please welcome TJ Stiles.
Well, my glasses are fine, but my printer broke, so I have to improvise. So after the poetry comes the prose. I am free to talk to you tonight, and you are free to listen because of freed slaves. Americans often think that our freedoms were bestowed by the founders, springing from their foreheads full-born, that freedom is a circle that was widened or that outsiders were allowed in, and that's not true. The first three words of the First Amendment say, Congress shall make no law. In 1833, Chief Justice John Marshall decided that those words mean exactly those words. States, he said, were free to abridge the Bill of Rights, our civil liberties, our individual rights for all. Needless to say, if you've studied anything about American history, is that those freedoms were most often abridged when it came to African Americans and the struggle against slavery. Southern states felt free to ban abolitionist writings, abolitionist speeches. The U.S. Postmaster General decided that he would not transmit abolitionist writings through the mail. There were also other civil liberties that were not protected, that were infringed by the states. In New England, they maintained state churches with taxpayer money. North Carolina, not until after the Civil War, you had to be a professing Christian, and of course a man, to be able to vote. Now this changed because of freed slaves. When the Civil War began, everyone expected them to keep working as before, because there was an ideology that they were a separate species, actually, and were by nature suited to slavery, and of course they were not. And so they rebelled in what historian Stephen Hahn calls the greatest slave rebellion in history. And before the Emancipation Proclamation, they broke down and destroyed the institution of slavery on the ground. When the war ended, the people who were in charge in the South, even in the federal government, assumed that Southern society would go back to being the way it was, minus the technicality of slavery. And African Americans proved them wrong. They asserted themselves, they organized schools, they formed political clubs, they had mass meetings, they sent petitions to Congress. And the South responded with state laws that placed them basically back under slavery. They responded with mass violence with the Ku Klux Klan, with police riots in Memphis and New Orleans that killed dozens of people. And Congress was forced to react. People in the North who were not racial egalitarians, congressmen who were not racial egalitarians, had to respond to this crisis, this self-assertion and this repression. Now, they saw it in terms of loyalty in the Civil War, that those who had stood by the Union, the true patriots in the South, had all been the former slaves. They were the ones who had stood for this Union. They were the ones who had stood for the Constitution. And they were being oppressed with impunity, murdered and brutalized with impunity by those who had rebelled against the United States. And so even those who were not, who were emphatically racist, I should say, in the North, decided they had to act. And so there came about a period called Reconstruction, the greatest wave of policymaking by the federal government in our history. That was a brief period in which there were African-American jurors, there were African-American voters, there were African-American justices of the peace and sheriffs and state legislators and congressmen and senators. During this brief period, Congress decided that it had to put these principles that it was putting into effect in the South into the Constitution to put it beyond the reach of politics. And so among other things, they passed the 14th Amendment. The 14th Amendment establishes the idea of race-neutral citizenship. If you are born in the United States, if you are naturalized as a citizen, it doesn't matter who your parents were, it doesn't matter what your genes are, you're a citizen. You're entitled to equal protection of the laws. You're entitled to your civil liberties, as well as civil rights. This was, as its principal framer put it on the floor of Congress, simply a proposition to arm the Congress with the power to enforce the Bill of Rights against the states. It was, in fact, the 14th Amendment, through what legal historians call the Incorporation Doctrine. It is why we are all free. It is why we have freedom of speech. It is why we enjoy the civil liberties that so many of us think were given to us by the founders, as by the gods, to the mortals below. In fact, it was a result of a process driven from the ground up by African Americans. Now, of course, the courts did not enforce these rights immediately. It was not until 1923 when the U.S. Supreme Court heard a case. The ACLU was defending a man named Gitlow, who was a radical socialist who had called for the overthrow of the U.S. government. And the ACLU said, thanks to the 14th Amendment, this man has freedom of speech. The New York State cannot throw him in jail for calling for the overthrow of the U.S. government. And the Supreme Court agreed. It accepted the Incorporation Doctrine. And so as a result of freed slaves, the most oppressed, the most scorned by Americans North and South, because of their self-assertion, they drove a crisis which changed the Constitution. Because of a radical socialist calling for the overthrow of the government, those principles were put into effect. So we have to remember that our rights, our liberties, are not given to us by those who are comfortable. They are not given to us by those who feel no need to test the limits of freedom. They're given to us by the oppressed. They're given to us by those who are pressing, sometimes in ways we may not agree with. That's the whole point. They're given to us by the dissenters. And that the idea of America, the idea that we have a country based on an idea, that it is belief in freedom and universal citizenship. We often talk about America as a republic which is based on ideas and not on ethnicity. This was not something that was a fact at the beginning of our republic. It was because of resistance. And so I am a free man today because of freed slaves and because of a radical who wanted to overthrow the US government. The American identity is diversity. The American identity is dissent. And so at moments when you are despairing, when there is a reaction, as there was when the Ku Klux Klan formed the first time, as there was when the Ku Klux Klan formed to keep Catholics and Jews out of the country in the 19-teens, as it was when the Ku Klux Klan came back in the 1950s and 60s to kill and oppress, as it was at other points in American history when people asserted, no, 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 you have to look like me to be an American. It's at these moments when we have rallied and we have made progress. And so, no, I don't think things are very bright right now, but I think that there's a chance they could be brighter in the future. Thank you.
Wow, thank you. Please, one more time for TJ Stiles. I am comfortable saying that up next is one of my favorite people on this earth. She is an Oakland writer and co-founder of Vona Voices of Our Nation's Arts and Voices. Her new book of poetry is This House, My Bones. Please join me in welcoming Elmaz Abinader.
Good evening. That's right. I'd like to thank Jane and Jack for inviting me and the library and the Friends of the Library and Litquake and all of you for coming on this kind of treacherous night. I know it wasn't easy. I also think it would be honest to say that what J.T. Stiles said tonight won't be showing up in textbooks. Just saying, but thank you for that. That was a beautiful connection. And having just seen the 14th, which is Ava DuVernay's documentary on mass incarceration, which I recommend to everybody, it's on Netflix. It's a wonderful, different kind of connection for me. So I'm happy to read tonight a letter. And this letter is the result of a book called Radical Hope. The editor of this book is Carolina De Robertis, and she has asked a number of writers from around the country to write a letter in response to this devastation that gives us some kind of radical hope. People like Juno Diaz and Cristina Garcia will be in this book. It's being published by Knopf. It is coming out in the first 100 days of the presidency. So I thought it would be appropriate tonight, since we're so close to that dark day, that I read this letter. And everybody took a different approach. Mine's called To the Woman Standing in Line at the Store. You are ahead of me, without a grocery basket, hugging 2 acorn squash, 4 ears of corn, and a can of oatmeal. Like many of us, you are wearing jeans and an open maroon sweater hitched up on the side where your purse is dangling. Your friend is leaning on a red shopping cart, her face close to a bouquet. Some of the flowers are unnaturally colored, a sea turquoise blue daisy, and a mango orange carnation, similar to the color of her hair. You are conversing in Spanish, slowly and measured, as if you know I am eavesdropping and need time to adjust to your accent, to rekey my ears. I'm not trying to listen to you, but your whisper, while urgent and private, is within earshot, and the words tutura and carcel command my attention. I want to know if you are telling a story about yourself or someone else. Was there a jail? What kind of jail? What kind of torture? As you speak, you don't change expression. I was there 10 years, and then they let me go. My mother had my children in Buenos Aires. They didn't know me anymore, so I left and came here. Your body stays still as you describe your trip from Argentina to Oakland, after a decade in prison, after giving up your children. Had I been further back in line or somewhere across the store, you would have been just another 40-something woman, just off work from Kaiser or my credit union, picking up something for dinner. And if I had imagined your conversation, it might have been about your hair appointment on Saturday, but I was near, a witness to the story of your time in prison, where you were tortured, leaving your shoulder frozen in one position. You are the woman standing in line at the grocery store, but you are also walking your kid to school near my house. You might be cleaning someone's bathroom or teaching a singing class, translating court documents, or counseling community college students. Not all of you are former prisoners. Some of you are refugees from countries that have collapsed or become too dangerous to live in. Many of you are dreamers, hoping to have nothing and then something to send back. You have walked across borders, fled a civil war, escaped the ruling party or a fanatic religious movement, or maybe you came here for an education and didn't go back. But for me, you are my Sittu, who during the fading Ottoman Empire in 1916 tucked the last of her jewelry into her waistband, crawled through the shrubbery, up and down the mountainsides to trade everything she had for rice, flour, and beans. She fed my mother and her sister at any cost. She traveled with them barefoot along the stony paths from the mountains to the cities, her belongings in a bundle on her head, to make the two-year journey that ended in Pennsylvania. And a half century later, her granddaughter, my cousin, sat in a fallout shelter while the city burned above her head. Her eyes cat-widened and her hearing dulled to the sounds of street blasts and missile cries. She is a mother in New Jersey conducting training for a software company. She is also a woman standing in line. The graduate student in my writing class who had to endure checkpoints and searches every day she moved through her town. The woman in my writing group who lived under two dictatorships. The mother of my student who escaped Pol Pot. They all make coffee and peel oranges, fold laundry and watch TV. The Filipina Lola, once a comfort woman for the Japanese soldiers, cradled her granddaughter in a stuffed chair in Daly City. My friend's sister, with over 50 pieces of shrapnel in her body, is now a master chef and magazine editor. You, women in line at the store, arrive every day. Most of you hold your stories inside while you transform your outside to a new person, taking cues from television. You stuff down the pain of buried children, your destroyed homes and lost languages, while you fill out forms and registration cards, sign leases and take driving tests. Dear woman standing in line at the store, I want to be attentive to you. Listen well to your whispers, find clues in the way you raise your hand while you talk or tuck your blouse into your waistband and lower your head. I want to hear the endearments you kneel to pour into the ears of your children, along with the instructions and messages. I don't want to unearth your journey out of greed or curiosity, but as a way to know you and let your story tell me who I might be. I am not courageous enough to put my back to my life, to whom I know, what I do, and how I live. I cannot imagine less in my life or separate from whom I love. I cannot fathom riding the boats that carried you, waving goodbye to my grandmother, paying the man who forged the papers, begging the minister to sign the visa, sneaking onto the train, holding my child, eating food from other people's hands, whispering endless prayers, matching the sound of my footprints. Many of us have not learned how to lose something, but you know, woman standing in line, that acorn squash you hold measures your heartbeat as you move from one world to the next, never betraying the spot where your life tore into. I can see there is a story under your skin, and I take courage from the steadiness of your breathing. I pray that the particles of hopefulness that brought you here will lift into the air, and we can inhale them into our systems, and they ease our journeys and yours too. Thank you.
So powerful, the lights went off. And so powerful, they came right back on again. Any DJ Khaled fans in the house? They don't want you to have lights when you're on stage. No? No? They don't want you to have water skis. They don't want you to be on, no, oh, okay. In the absence of Faith Adele, we have a little bit of time for me to share with you a quick story. And so as I select it, I would like to do a quick mic check to know, how are we with clits, tits, and dicks? I just want to do a quick clit, tit, and dick mic check. Are we okay with clits, dicks, and tits? I am on our podcast, Good Muslim, Bad Muslim, I recently came out as bisexual. And it felt important to me to do so in the wake of the Orlando shooting, where this wonderful thing happened, where the conservative right was asking Muslims all over the country, are you a terrorist or are you homophobic? Are you a terrorist or are you homophobic? Are you a terrorist or are you homophobic? And Muslims were like, just homophobic, thanks. And I became so frustrated, and so it was important to me to come out, even as a straight passing married woman. And everyone would keep asking me, like, well, but really? And this is really random. I've never told this story before, I'm excited to tell it here because I have so many famous authors to workshop it with. The only way that I was able to, like, know for myself, like, who I am and what I rub off to was you porn. And so I'm just very worried about what Julian Assange is going to do to that site. It's too much? Because it's going to get worse. So how are we doing? Okay. It is possible for me to dissipate into humiliation. Don't do that to me. We are now in this together. And if this story is horrible and graphic, you did it too. Okay, so I'm gonna share the story of the one time that I was with a woman back in college. What's up, Dad? It's a live YouTube stream, cool. how are we doing? Okay. And I was really excited because everybody had told me that when you're with a woman, woman knows another woman's body and they're like, you know each other's bodies and you're just like, eh. And she's gonna know your body, and you're gonna know her body, and you're just like gonna come and come and come and come and come and come and come. And I was like really stoked. So, and she had a big crush on me. And the reason why I wanted to go out with her is because my ex-boyfriend had a crush on her. And I wanted to destroy him. And so I did it by going out with her. And maybe she would give me 1,000 orgasms. And then I could tell my ex-boyfriend, I came more than you ever made me with a woman that you wanted. No, we're just terrified of me? Okay. That's fine. And like, I took off her clothes, she took off my clothes, and I was like, oh, I want your body. But I also like, want your body. Her breasts were better than mine. And like, I was so excited because everyone had told me, like, when you're with another woman, you're a woman and she's a woman, and you're just like, then you're not gonna have to fake it. Which, like, being with a lot of men, is, we fake it a lot. ladies.
Don't leave me alone here. All right, there it is. There it is. The only people brave enough. How are we doing? Clits, dits, tits, dicks. Good. Okay. And so, like, she like rips off my pants, like, and I was just like, oh my God. And she's like, what do you like? And I was like, no man has ever asked me that. I was not prepared for that. I didn't know. And I wanted to be cool, so I said, biting. And all of my friends had promised that when you're with another woman, you don't have to fake it. And so she went down, and she bit me on my clit. And I went, ah! And she went, ar, 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 ar. And I went, oh, 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 shit! I have to fake liking somebody gnawing on my clit. And so anyway, that's the one time. Thank you. Up next is the best-selling author of Boonville, writer and producer of the film Pig Hunt, and author of the play The Death of Teddy Ballgame, a former minor league prospect. He is a full-on Giants fanatic. Here is Robert Mailer Anderson.
I feel close to compelled to tell my story about when I slept with a hermaphrodite and didn't know. We might be here for different reasons, but clearly I have been amongst them, meaning the politicos and the 1% and the ruling class, for a little bit now. And I haven't been able to really make sense of things in general. In fact, during this election cycle, I think I turned to my wife and said, you look, I have a pretty good imagination, and I've seen a lot of stuff for someone who's 48, different economic classes, different parts of this country, from rural to city, and the amount of sexism that's going on here is just past me. I couldn't get my head around it. And there came another point when I felt the same thing about race. So I kind of tried to go back to basics. I didn't know if this is supposed to be hopeful or what we're supposed to offer up in 5 minutes or so here. It's an interesting obstacle ball of what to do next. And we can be kind of Pollyannish about it. I have some ideas. There's a lot of really good things that are happening, believe it or not. I mean, we all live in San Francisco. We're all in California. The fact that the brain trust didn't bleed into a Hillary Clinton administration means people like Eric Holder, people who are ready to work for the NRDC, for the ACLU, for the environment. These people are all there, and they're going to be working for us. And we have to implement it, because these are unbelievably scary times. I don't know how much I have to tell you that or break it down, or how much is being run down in your mind. I mean, this isn't really a checklist type situation of Russian invasion and how much, or the FBI coming out and why. I mean, it's all pretty odd. The other good news is that, despite what happens now, if a game plan is put together. I think going back, reading through a couple emails, I just spent 5 minutes and went back almost a year to see what I was thinking about. And so I'd like to read a couple of those and then leave you with like maybe one last sort of linking thought about what may be like progress or what that could look like. So on February 10th, and speaking to Trump, What can you say? But this is not our finest moment as a nation. It reminds me of those nativist parties in Europe where outright racists and anti-Semites get skinhead backing and anti-immigrant vote, but they don't have the same system. They just get a few seats or a minority voice in parliament or something. This small bloc could hijack the presidency. February 12th. And Trump has the ignorant vote, which won't become educated anytime soon. The conservatives are splitting their third of the Republican Party with the rest of the candidates by allowing these nut jobs to hijack their Tea Party. February 18th. Since I brought up gambling, and it used to be sports betting for me, indulge my next sports analogy of this primary and general election. Boy, we were still in the primary. Those were the good old days. Regardless of how good you are, it is difficult to sweep a World Series. So when Hillary's camp says they were going to sweep the World Series, primaries and general election, I'm skeptical. It just doesn't happen often. And when I analyze a team, my gambler self says, this is not the team to sweep. They're going to lose at least one game, if not more. Now that doesn't mean Hillary won't win the World Series, but as a spectator over many years, I've seen what happens when a team underestimates its opponents and gets put back on its heels. In fact, I've seen this same Hillary team claim they were going to sweep the World Series and in fact lose to another underdog long shot already. An underdog is used to losing and can take their losses in stride and still put forth their best game. A favorite often has problems with losses and doesn't put their best game forward when they encounter setbacks, especially if they didn't prepare for those setbacks. Hillary is again unprepared. I think they've underestimated the youth vote, the black vote, the feminist vote, and most importantly, the blue-collar vote. She's going to lose a few games, and isn't it even if she wins these games, they're going to be much closer than she thinks. I'd bet on it. I'm still not certain Hillary's electable. She doesn't inspire Dems, and she may motivate Republicans to oppose her en masse. I don't see Cruz people switching. I don't see Trump's people swaying. And I don't know how many of the Republican establishment will venture over, regardless of how crazy Cruz and Trump are, because they hate Hillary so much and have had bad blood with the Clinton machine. This is a much, much, much longer conversation. But yes, this is like 2 weeks later. But yes, it is sad that Americans believe that Trump is a hero instead of a carnival barker snake oil salesman, that he is and should be tarred and feathered and run out of town or any decent civil society. Unfortunately, both Republicans and Dems are responsible for this mess caused by faulty public schools, deregulation of industry, vilifying workers' unions and the corruption within those unions, massive incarceration, Citizens United, dominant drug addiction ranging from OxyContin to crack, alcohol and marijuana, over-the-counter and prescribed pills, not to mention the dopamine hits from video games, TV and cell phones, and that loop of constant consumption and advertising, negative food value, depression. You can't suddenly want people to think clearly or analytically from that clusterfuck. May 16th. By the way, Trump is scaring me. He understands the medium of celebrity and TV and middle America on its gut instant gratification, no sense of history, fearful, worst level. The Sunday front page New York Times piece was a good example of a hit piece that will only convert the already converted. This was the one where there was a talk about the beauty pageant women, and secretly sway the undecided to the dark side. It's a closed loop. Meanwhile, he feeds the beast. Even President Carter lusted in his heart, so not too many men are going to blame Trump for groping Miss America contestants, even if it is a clear crime. They'll think, isn't that why the pageant exists? It will be tycoon man's man Trump versus the word of a sachet-wearing bimbo who wanted it. As Hillary Camp keeps pretending, there are more voters who watch Girls on HBO than NASCAR, or The Apprentice, or that she's actually likable and eventually people will come to their senses and vote for the less odious of two candidates. Is that even sensible? Remember Cicciolina, Reagan, Schwarzenegger, Clint Eastwood, Jesse Ventura, hell, Al Franken, Eva Perón? Who, with any such name value and celebrity success, has lost? So I guess rushing through that makes you wonder, like, what is it that we can do this next time, this next easy election cycle? And so just to take a quick minute of a kind of Pollyannish connection, I would say we're writers and we're smart. We need to control the narrative and take back words. We have to be very, very careful with the words that we use, and we have to shift those words that aren't working and are bloated, are no longer valuable that they've inserted. The same kind of thing happens when the Pentagon gives us words like collateral damage that means women and children, right? We can't go on talking about these things. We have to call lies lies. We have to use other terms too to think about things, and this is one of them, like a growth economy. I mean, what does that look like in a real world that's connected, right? What is growth? I mean, not to sound too much like a Marxist, but what is the capital? Well, if the capital is the world itself, then anything that rises is going to fall down somewhere else. There is no growth. I mean, physics tell us that, right? So now we have to talk about an active economy. Otherwise, what you're seeing is basically growth going up like a circus tent. And it looks really big, but when you get in there, it's only serving the pole. The pole is the only thing going on in that. The rest is just air. And within that tent, we need activity, and that's the way we need to count it. So back to that activity is going to have to be us getting together and making human choices and erring on the side of being human. And that's also going to be not erring on the side of convenience and looking at some of the things that we have that we use, not necessarily as services, but the people behind them. Because when we want our Uber cars here faster, or our driverless cars that are about to unemploy 5 million truckers or more, what is the name of this? This is some kind of profit? This is some kind of growth? It's a very small thing. So not to sound like a complete technophobe, but part of the thing is we need to move away from some of the electronica and some of the ease, and we need to move back into a kind of a human realm. And then that's going to be the crux of it. I told a friend of mine who's the head of the Department of Transportation, we were talking about things, and I ended up saying, look, there may not be anything better than a damn bus stop. There may not be anything better than a subway station. You have to. It's a very democratic place. You have to meet your neighbor. You have to look at them. You have to interact with them. You have to learn to get along with them. You're forced to care on some level. Whereas if you get in from point A to point B and rush in your back seat of your driverless car, there's just nothing there. And it turns out, too, the same thing happens when every time, you know, all the stuff here. We're all from San Francisco, so hopefully this is preaching to the converted. 101. We have to buy locally and act locally and walk around our own damn communities and clean them up. And I don't mean law and order clean it up. I mean pick that up. I'm a father of four. Pick that up from the environment on down. Wonder where that wrapper came from. Look at it. Think about how when Amazon comes here, it's a jet stream with packaging that comes to you, and you did not have that conversation with whoever that cashier was that you should have, and that other store that you should have walked down there and spent all that time in your community. And that's just on a basic consumption level. But I see two dear friends here. I used to work in a used bookstore. And the conversation about books, which we should all care about, you know, you just see the buffalo of Amazon's returns, right? Now, Amazon is saying that they have X amount of jobs and they're expanding in this growth economy. But the truth is, Macy's is closing, like all these other places and retail places are closing, these anchor stores are closing, and everybody feels the hurt of all of that. And the conversation is gone. The flesh and blood conversation is gone, and we're losing our communities, and we're becoming more fearful and depressed in this sort of loop. So I think next time around we can beat this guy across the board. It should be, you know, Russians and FBI aside, freedom of speech that's going to come under a complete attack right now. I mean, we're ready for this kind of thing. The other good news that nobody in this room really wants to hear is I think the CIA has had enough. Aside from laying off 5 million truckers, I would not fuck with the CIA. He doesn't have, let us get back into the hopeful realm. He doesn't have a consolidated front. He doesn't have any ideology. No ideology. He's somebody that wants to get richer and bloated, and like it's alarming, right? But it's a good news for us, because ideologically, Cruz, Pence, Kasich, all these other people, Sessions, I mean, these are horrible fucking people. Trump is horrible as well, but he has no ideology to get anybody much more motivated than instant corporate interests. And his corporate interests actually are not consolidated either. And there's other factions that we can get behind, especially here in California, right, where we do have renewable energy, we have all kinds of things, we're the sixth biggest economy. So this is the other thing I have to say, and I don't know how it's gonna work, but you guys are all smarter than I am in this room. Watch the tech sector. They are not our friends. They are not our friends, I have to say. Sorry about that. I know they helped put up the library. They put their names on a lot of things. But for the most part, they're not our friends. And they're much more interested in this merger. I forget what they're calling it. I don't want to sound completely out of it. But the merger of AI and humanity? I mean, no. Like, what the fuck is that? Like. You should be worried in all kinds of cleaning the bay, getting clean air. Like, that is a really weird thing to, and in your own home, fine, right? In the privacy of your own home, I'm from San Francisco, do whatever you want. But you can't inflict that on all of us here. So the one thing that we're gonna have to think about in California, the sixth biggest economy, is how do we tighten our laws and woo the tech sector that is Silicon Valley to stay here? Because Peter Thiel and other people will go. They will go, and the deregulation that they're going to give to the states will create tax loopholes and laws for these corporations to leave. Google, Amazon, right? These are big companies. Google already tried it in Ireland, right? They will leave. They will reduce our revenue here in California for blue state causes, and they will go into red states. They will be wooed by Texas, they will be wooed by other places, and those are the alarming places that we have to keep that business and that corporation here so their revenue doesn't go into red states to control women's bodies and to continue with xenophobia and all kinds of, you know, climate denying craziness. So we have to be vigilant and we have to be human. So just err on humanity and watch the tech sector and our laws here. When we can get more states' rights, let's sew them up for a pathway for immigration, for better labor. Labor's been under siege. I know there's corruption within the unions, but the only connection that our Berkeley economist that won the Nobel Prize can see between the massive amounts of wealth, right, in this country and elsewhere, we just saw that 8 people own as much money as half the goddamn world, and that's probably not including some Saudi who's got a bunch of gold bricks and who knows what somewhere, right? That's all stuff that's been accountable for, right? Not just saying. Labor, unions are decreasing, and wealth is increasing. So we've got to unionize, and unionize means every day, again, from neighborhoods to work, solidarity across everything. So that's what I leave you with. Err on human side, and let us watch the tech sector, and let us beat the shit out of Trump the next time.
You took my paper. Andrew, will you repeat after me? Say law. Yes, I'm sorry. Robert Anderson. Mr. Robert Anderson. Do you know about a guy named Muhammad?
A man named Muhammad?
Yes.
I believe I do.
Have you ever heard of Allah?
Allah?
Yeah.
With a different pronunciation, yes.
Perfect. Can you say law? Ilaha.
Allah.
Ilallah. You're Muslim now. Thank you. You still have the rest of my paper. This is the 1%.
Take it all if you can.
Talking about labor.
raised a comic through and through. It's tough to stick.
How about that?
You're only going to give me part of it?
I thought that. No, I gave you the other piece.
Just leave it to a white man to take my content! I'm watching you. Like the NSA. I'm not watching porn all the time. All right, how are you guys doing? Yeah? 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 Our next author was raised in Nigeria, and her writing includes essays, academic papers, reviews, and short stories. She has published the book Independence and the upcoming novel Like a Mule Bringing Ice Cream to the Sun. She teaches literature at San Francisco State University. Please welcome Sarah Ladipo Manyika.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to Litquake, and thank you to the library. I think it's particularly apt that we're having this conversation in the library, which is one of the few remaining public spaces that remains unsegregated socially and economically. And I think that's very important, so thank you. I'm going to read a piece that I wrote last month, and I'll entitle it, for the purposes of tonight, January's People. On election day, I flew out of San Francisco to London. The last time I'd done this was on the eve of Brexit. And as with that flight, many passengers were nervously checking mobile devices before takeoff. We were informed that the pilot had decided not to announce election results for fear of a mid-flight eruption. But for those who cared to check, there would be intermittent internet access. One passenger took this as his cue to preemptively declare a winner. And as if further proof were needed of his Trump allegiance, he proceeded to make crude passes at the flight attendant. Hours later, when he let out a celebratory yelp and pumped the air with his fists, we all knew who had won. "You're in my country now," a British woman snapped at him as we landed. "I don't give a fuck," he laughed. "I can do what I want." "When you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything," I recalled Donald Trump's lines from the infamous Access Hollywood tape. As we disembarked, I scrolled through text messages from friends expressing shock, disbelief, and two pleas. One, "Sarah, please don't fly on an election day again." And the second, "May God have mercy on us." I'd been worried for months that the American election would go the way that it did. And I'd written about it, drawing on the Nigerian expression, "shine your eyes," in the hope that we might all see more clearly the inequalities and the ever-growing disconnect between established parties and the electorate. Having grown up in Nigeria and Kenya, I've witnessed how quickly democracies can unravel. I've seen the appeal of a big man promising to make a country great. And I've seen how these men stay in power by muzzling the press, intimidating the opposition, and rigging elections with or without foreign aid. But the fact that I'd foreseen America's election result didn't reduce my shock upon hearing it. Having arrived in London, I lamented the election results with friends, all the while aware, as with Brexit, that we were busy lamenting in gentrified parts of London. The fact that most of us could jet from one city to another immediately marked us as different to many who felt left behind by globalization and their governments. I would later meet two men, both part-time Uber drivers, struggling to make ends meet, who believed in Trump's self-proclaimed business smarts and expected him to rule America well. But even their admiration for Trump was not without reservation. "All of these things, Brexit and Trump," said one who was Nigerian, "are the shakings of end times. They are the fulfillments of the Book of Revelation." "May God have mercy on us," I muttered. I'd come to London en route to Abeokuta, Nigeria, to attend the Ake Arts and Book Festival, where authors and attendees continue to speculate about the reason for Trump's win. Some of us took part in school visits, and when the headmistress of the school that I visited learned that I lived in America, she shook her head in sympathy. "We'll pray for you," she said, which sounded like something Americans used to say about the rest of the world. Brexit and Trump's win had not only ushered in political reversals, but these results were reversing the way the rest of the world viewed Britain and America, with people in so-called third world countries pitying us. Nigeria had its problems, yet Nigerians were offering those of us living in America a place to stay if need be. By the end of November, my despair at the prospect of a Trump presidency had deepened. Despair at his twittering and flittering away of what remained of the world's precarious peace. And despair that for all his talk of making America great, and we won't even go into the again bit, social and economic divides would only deepen. An accountant friend of mine recently transferred from Harare, Zimbabwe, to St. Louis, Missouri, said, "You know, from the movies, you picture an America where everyone has it easy. And then you get to the place, and you see that so many people seem to be struggling." There's no denying that America has failed many of its citizens, and that out of desperation, people look for saviors. In America, these saviors had emerged as Bernie or Trump, with parallels in other parts of the world. If not politicians, then charismatic religious leaders. And I sat next to one such leader when flying out of Lagos. I watched as grown men prostrated before him, their hands clasping his shiny red shoes, calling him Daddy. One such admirer informed me that I was blessed beyond measure to be sitting next to this apostle, known for his miracles and prophecies. And then, in the midst of my despair, I too was drawn to a savior figure. At the beginning of December, I met Pope Francis. I'd accompanied my husband to a meeting of business leaders in Rome, and it was in this context that we were granted an audience with the Pope. I listened to the Pope's words, to the way he was holding the CEOs accountable, and I felt relieved. He said, in Italian, "Involve in your efforts those whom you seek to help. Give them voice. Listen to their stories. Learn from their experiences and understand their needs. See in them a brother and a sister and a son and a daughter, a mother and a father. Amid the challenges of our day, see the human face of those you earnestly seek to help." The Pope's humility and his emphasis on human dignity touched me. And yet, as I dwelt on his words, it struck me that what I heard might be similar to what others heard in the lines of Trump's victory speech. Every single American will have the opportunity to realize his or her fullest potential. The forgotten men and women of our country will be forgotten no longer. As humans, we need hope. We also need leaders. In Pope Francis, I saw a man whose life reflects the ideals he espouses and whose integrity and humility are befitting of a leader. I returned to America with a little less despair and a flicker of hope, knowing that there are some world leaders who walk their talk and whose message is not driven by political expediency or a hunger for power. My flight back coincided with another election. But this time, when I landed, Austria's far-right presidential candidate had lost. And snap.
Our final presenter is author of the book Southern Front and This War Called Love, both winners of the American Book Award, as well as the collection Stray Poems. He was a founding member and first director of the Mission Cultural Center and is a professor in Latino Studies at San Francisco State University. Please welcome the current San Francisco Poet Laureate, Alejandro Murguia.
Thank you, Sarah, for that very generous introduction. But you forgot to mention that I also make really good breakfast burritos. And of course, I want to thank Litquake, San Francisco Public Library, I think one of the great libraries of our country. And remember that all classical cities always had great libraries. So I want to thank Luis Herrera and the Friends of the Library and the Litquake for putting together this event, allowing us to come together in a community to celebrate literature and art and poetry while so much of the world is racked with violence and war, intolerance and hatred. So I want to thank you for being here tonight. And because you told your stories about, I got to tell you the story that one time, I had an affair with a woman who was a Republican. But I didn't know it at the time. And now she's a flaming radical. And that's the power of poetry. And I very much appreciated all of the authors who have read and the very great and brilliant talk by T.J. Stiles. Thank you very much for that. And I also like very much this quote by Margaret Atwood, that there is no shadow without light. And it's kind of also a riff on the question of physics that Robert brought up, because physics tells us that for every action, there is an equal but opposite reaction. So while this reaction is coming at us, later on, our reaction, physics, will push the other way. And I think it's important that we keep it in that sort of scientific way. It's not that it's going to happen any other way. That's what physics tells us will happen. So part of our contribution, perhaps, is to be involved in that counterpoint. And let me just say a few things before I read this one poem. I was very pleased to see Representative Lewis point out that this man is an illegitimate president. But it's not just because he lost the popular vote. It's not just because there was incredible voter suppression. It's not just because a foreign power intervened in these elections to cook it for him or help him cook it. But the real reason he is an illegitimate president is because he hasn't shown us his birth certificate. Because we have dropped the standards so low, right, that how do we know he wasn't born in Russia? But it also, I think, raises the question, and we will shape it as we go forward, somewhat a rhetorical question, but also perhaps a philosophical question. What is the role of literature? What is the role of poetry? And like I said, we will shape that role as we go forward, as we're shaping it tonight. But I always like to paraphrase the great Uruguayan writer, Eduardo Galeano, who says, and I'm paraphrasing, to think that society can be changed by poetry is absurd. But to think that society can be changed without poetry is equally absurd. And so the role of poetry is not just prophecy, but I think also, and to be true to the word, as Robert Mailer Anderson also mentioned, right? One of the sort of guiding philosophies of Eduardo Galeano, especially in these times, that we must be true to the word. But also I think part of the power of poetry is to satirize and ridicule the powerful. So now before I read this poem, I don't want to scare anybody, but there is a chisme going around our neighborhood. Chisme, anybody? Yeah, well, in our neighborhood, chisme is way better than Twitter. And the chisme that's going around is that when he takes the oath to pay close attention, because he will not actually put his hand on the Bible, but keep it about 10 centimeters above. And so the camera angles will look like he's putting his hand, but he won't, because if he puts his hand on the good book, it will explode in flames. So the point of all of this is, you will know the devil when you meet him. Remember, when the devil comes for your country, he won't be sporting a pointy tail or pitchfork. Hell no. He will appear in a fancy suit and lathered in expensive cologne to hide the stink of sulfur, and live in a high tower where he will surround himself with gold, which at night he will turn into dog shit. You will never see him at church or place of worship, a shrine, an altar, because his orange hair would catch fire, revealing his horns. He will never show his birth certificate, because they don't hand those out in the ninth level of hell. You will know him by his destruction of God's creation. He will pollute the air and poison the water, annihilate bees and butterflies, unleash tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, and call it a hoax. And his followers, to prove their loyalty, and this comes right out of the Inquisition handbook, must first lick his arsehole and eat maggots in his presence. Remember this when the devil comes to steal your country, if you still have a country. And now, to make sure the poem gets to its intended recipient, I will now perform an imitation of Jimi Hendrix. And Luis is gonna hate me for it, but that's how it goes. Thank you.
Thank you all for an incredible evening. Please join me in giving one more round of applause to our incredible authors, Devorah Major, TJ Stiles, Elmaz Abinader, Robert Mailer Anderson, Sarah Ladipo Manyika, Alejandro Muerga. I have been your host and MC, Zahra Noorbakhsh. I promised myself tonight that despite how scared I am, I would get up on stage and I would take every risk that I could think of. So thank you for joining. Say one more word. The books are available in the lobby. And I will be there with my cunt. Have a great night. Thank you.